In this week's stock market analysis, we will take a look at the S&P 500 using technical analysis, and also we're going to review the stock market internals and the sentiment indicator to see, has the market actually put in a bottom recently? And then we're going to take a look at the gold, the oil, and the U.S. dollar. News just came through the wire that OPEC has agreed to a production cut, so that will be interesting to see some of the price action in the coming week. So before I continue, let me remind you to click the thumbs up if you find the content in this video to be useful and informative to you. And also click the subscribe if you are not a subscriber to this channel. So last week, the jobless claim shot up to over 6 million. And now there's over 16 million American unemployed, and that put the unemployment rate around that 10% level. So one would think the market would have sold off, but as it turned out, that's to the contrary. The market has actually went up on Friday, and for the week, it actually went up about 12%, or a little bit over 301 point in a week. So that is something to to ponder on. Why is the market selling off while the unemployment is getting gloomier? Well, the Fed have put in some backstop to bail out some of the junk bond, and the Fed is just keep printing money and running the printing press. So it would be interesting to see how long the Fed could change the narrative, because we're going to come back for another week of jobless claim. And most likely this coming week, we probably will push the total unemployment somewhere around, you know, over 20 million American unemployed, and that would push the unemployment rate up to 15% or so, so we'll see how that will turn out, or even could get some people would even venture out and guess 20%. So we'll see how that narrative, how the Fed will be able to constantly change that narrative and move the market away from focusing on this jobless claim number. So in any way, looking at this long-term monthly chart here, as you can see, the price in March, it dipped below and broke out of this long-term megaphone channel that is established from the March 2009 low to the February 2020 high, and it dip below this megaphone channel and into this Fibonacci retracement zone, in which I have the Fibonacci retracement zone set up based on this long-term swing here from the 2009 low to the 2020 high. It dipped into this retracement zone and bounced back and closed out the month of March back into this megaphone channel. And on April, remember last week, the video was saying, April is kind of start out at a negative tone. It was right underneath this megaphone trend line here, this lower trend line. But as you can see from last week's action, they actually pushed the S&P 500 back substantially back into this megaphone channel. It's on the one-third distance above the lower channel trend line here. So that's extraordinary. And also, if you look at the low from the March 23rd low to last Friday's close, the market or the S&P 500 have bounced off from its low around 27%, and it's almost gained 600 points in less than 3 weeks. So go and figure that out. The main thing that we want to focus here in this video is look at the market internal and see what is the market telling us internally. Is it getting weaker or getting stronger? Is the recent low is something for us to pay attention, that most likely will the market will put in another low? So those are the questions that we're going to try to answer. Not necessarily that we will have a definitive answer, but we're going to take a look at it to see what the market is telling us most likely the situation is. So here we are looking at the daily chart of the S&P 500. As you can see, I have reformatted the chart with the S&P 500, and the stock market internal and the sentiment indicator. So let me go and describe to you what I have on this chart here. Down here, this one here is the cumulative advance decline of the New York Stock Exchange. And this is basically the indicator, the internal being derived by using the daily net difference between the number of advancing issue minus the number of declining issue. So if we have more advancing issue than declining issue, then that net difference will be positive, and that value will be added to the previous sum. Okay, and if the there are more declining issue than advancing issue, then that net difference will be negative, and that number, that value will basically, you know, subtract from the previous sum. And that's how we keep a running cumulative sum. Okay, and the way that I use this is not based on you know, the absolute value or doing technical analysis on trend line, resistance, support level, because these are not tradable value, right, or indexes or whatever. Okay, these are basically is what is happening in the market based on what is the overall stock in the market is doing. Are they advancing or declining? Yes, you know, people trade individual stocks, so indirectly it could influence that. But it doesn't have a, say, oh, when it hit this level, then everybody going to sell all those stock and then push the advanced decline line down. You know, it doesn't happen that way. And the way that I use it is basically looking at for divergence. Right, because if you look at it, you know, if the advance, if the market is going up, for example, in this case, we're using the S&P 500. If the S&P 500 is going up, we expect that there will be more advancing issue than declining issue to push that index up, and that kind of reinforce there is strength in the market to push the index up. Right, so there's no divergence there. But if the index is going up, and the number of issue that is advancing is actually less than the number of issue declining, that means there are less amount of stock pushing the market up, and there are more selling pressure internally. There's more, well, basically more weakness internally. Then that market move, you know, going up is not supportive. Okay, so eventually that you know, that momentum will give way because you have less stock pushing that market up. Now you say, why could that happen? Well, because the index is weighted. So if you get a couple of these heavy weighted stock by lifting it up, then it could give a false move to the index and make it appear that it's going up, while majority of the other stock within that index or in the exchange as a whole, in this case, the New York Stock Exchange, is actually moving down. Then it kind of give you the false impression that the market is actually, you know, going up. But internally, you can see that there is weakness, and eventually the market will give way and then will come back down. And that's why I look for these divergences to kind of get a gauge or clue to be prepared for a change in direction. Right? It could be a near-term, you know, short impulse move, okay? But nevertheless, it gives you a sense of what to look for. Is the market actually gaining strength or getting weaker? Right, so vice versa, if the index is going down and there are actually more advancing issue than a declining issue, that means internally the market is building up strength. So eventually that index will turn around and move back up. So that's how I use the advanced decline, is using monitoring for divergence. Okay, you know, positive divergence is when we have the advanced decline moving up while the index is moving down, and the negative divergence is the index moving up and the advanced decline is moving down. So I typically call this, people call this the AD line, right, for short, right? So that's how I use this advanced decline or the AD line. Then the next one here is the VIX. This is more of a fear index. Right, it gauges the amount of fear going into the market, the amount of fear coming out of the market. So when this indicator is moving up, that means there are more fear coming into the market, then people will be liquidating their position and taking risks off. So you will see as this index move up, then this indicator move up, the sentiment indicator move up, then you could see the index, in this case, the S&P 500, should come down, because as people taking risks off, then essentially selling off their position, liquidating their position to cut, or to reduce risk, then you see the index come down. And similarly, if the VIX is going down, that means fear is coming out of the market, then that means people is feeling more confident, more bullish, then they tend to put on more risk, then you see the index will go up. Now, the way that I use this index is basically looking at extreme. Okay, what I mean by extreme is look at these, when they get up to an elevated level, very high, and spike up, then you expect there to be a reaction, because you got a lot of people that are so scared, it's already sold out, right? You're taking off. So when you have a lot of people leaning on one side of the trade, then you basically are looking at the opposite side of trade for the opportunity. Okay, then that's also the other thing is, is when this index is above 20 or higher, then typically that's when fear is coming into the market. Then you will see that there will be some sort of a correction or pullback. But when this index is below 20, and especially in the last few years, we've basically seen a lot of times the VIX is basically sitting somewhere in the low teen. That means there are very little fear in the market, and people just being very complacent. And you see that a lot of people is basically just taking a lot of risks. And sometimes it's extraordinary risks that they don't realize, because they feel that there is no risk in the market. And that's when the market will tend to surprise everyone, right? Okay, because the market has a tendency to catch majority of the people, right? So that's how I use it, is basically looking at the extreme. Not much of the divergence, sometimes it happens, but not always, because you basically look at extreme. And you can see here at this day here on March 16, you see this spike up, more than 80, right? So that's really high. And you see that the S&P 500 closed at 2386.13. And then you see on this day on March 23rd, it actually closed lower, but the VIX is also lower. So it kind of gives you a little bit of a negative divergence. But again, you see this extreme 80 and it starts coming down. And then, with the VIX coming down while the index is moving lower, that kind of gives you some idea that maybe a lot of the people that have been scared out earlier is starting to, sort of buying. And right here, maybe it's just some sort of the last hold out capitulation. That could be it also. So those are the things to keep an eye on. And look at Friday, it's still at 41.67, so it's still relatively high comparing to the level of 20 or below. So there's still a lot of fear in the market, although, it have came down substantially from the plus 80 level, but there are still a lot of fear in the market. So even though we see the S&P 500 is making its move back up, so that's how I use the this VIX, the fear indicator, or this sentiment indicator here, okay, is by looking, monitoring for extreme, okay, at the low side and also on the high side. Then the next one here is the put-call ratio, because we're basically looking at the put-call ratio between the boundary of 1 and 0.75. When you get above 1, that means there are a lot of people putting hedges on or buying protection, basically buying put to protect the downside, on the existing position. And when it gets above 1, then you got a lot of people is basically just coming in, playing on the downside and more of a hedge and protection. But when it gets below 0.75, then you got people that's basically getting a little bit speculative and bullish, so they're betting on the upside. So I sort of call this using Buffett's terminology, you know, the greed and the fear indicator, right? So when you get below 0.75 and especially get down to the 0.6 or 0.5 level, that's the greedy part of the market. You know, people just think that the market is just going to go up. So they're just speculating and they're buying the call, betting on the upside. But once you get above one, then it's the fear factor coming in, right? People are getting scared and they're basically buying protection to protect their long position. Okay, so that's, you know, and the way that I use that, again, you know, we're basically looking at the zone here, you know, this plus one and below 0.75. Then again, we look for extreme, just like the VIX, okay, these sentiment indicator, you basically look for extreme, you know, how people react based on that extreme moment. Are they getting very scared or very euphoric, right? Or optimistic, you know, overly optimistic. Okay, so that's basically how I use it. And on Friday, this put-call ratio is 0.91. So it's still relatively high, although it is inside the zone and it is coming down. So we'll see, would it come down to this 0.75 area in the coming week and continue to push this, you know, the S&P 500 to a higher level, or would it basically chop around here at this 0.9, 0.8 and then, you know, peak its head above the one level as the S&P 500, you know, pull back a little bit. So we'll see how that play out in the coming week. And here we're looking at the New York you know, New York Stock Exchange new high, new low. This is basically a graph of the daily amount of issue traded in the New York Stock Exchange make new 52-week high. And the difference between the new 52-week high and the new 52-week low. So if the there are more new high than new low, then we get a positive number. If there's more new low than new high, then we get a negative number, right? So again, we're basically looking for a little bit of divergence here, right? You know, because if majority of the stock in the New York Stock Exchange is making new low and the index is not making a new low, that's a negative divergence. But if a majority of the stock is not making new high, but the market or the index, in this case, the S&P 500 is making new high, then we kind of see that, you know, I think the strength is getting weaker and weaker internally to push this index up to a new high level. So that's how I use it, is basically looking at divergence. Because if you look at here, right, on this day here, the what's this? This is March 12th. Right, you look at the amount of new low that we have. It's overwhelming. Right, it's 2,380 stock making new 52-week low on March 12th, and the index, the S&P 500 closed at 2,480.64. Right. Okay. Now, let's put this in context here. There's a little bit over 3,000 issues traded in the New York Stock Exchange on a daily basis, okay? And now you're talking about 2,380 of that 3,000-some-odd stock is making new 52-week low. That is extraordinary selling pressure pushing those stocks to see a 52-week low, right? So it's basically, you know, people are just selling that like, hey, get me out at any price, I don't care, right? So you see the fear in that market and the selling pressure on that particular day when you see this amount of stock making new low, right? You know, so it's basically, it's like 75% of the stock that were traded in the New York Stock Exchange that particular day is making new low, right? And then here you see here on this day here on March 23rd, right? You see that the S&P 500 closed at a new low at 2,237.40. But look at the your new high, new low, right? It's only minus 771. See, here we see the S&P 500 closed at a new low, but the new high, new low is actually much higher than the prior low on the new high, new low. I believe this is the March 12th, right? So that kind of tells you that, hey, even though this index went to make a new low, but majority of the stock in the New York Stock Exchange is trading above 52 week low. Now you say, well, why would that happen? Well, again, get back to the way that the index is constructed. It's based on weighted, you know, stock, right? You know, using the weighted factor on the stock. So typically, right, when you sell the less quality stock first, and then you hold out the higher quality stock last. And usually the higher quality stock has a higher weight, right? So that's the reason why you would normally see a lower low, you know, on the index with a, you know, maybe a higher low of some of the internals. Okay, so you could see how that, you know, the dynamic of the internal and the index work. That's why it's important when you monitor the market, you have to look at the market internals, right, to see the true strength and weakness underneath the index inside the market. Okay, so a lot of people basically just look at the price and moving average and that sort of thing. I mean, it's good for analyzing price action, but if you want to see the underlying strength and weakness of the market, you really have to look at those stock market internals. So you could see that on Friday, we actually saw a positive 11. In other words, you know, there are 11 more new high than new low on Friday. Now, it's not significant because the number is so low, but the significance here is that look at this here, almost, you know, month and a half, right? You know, okay? Yeah, the new high, new low be primarily dominant by more new low than new high. Then all of a sudden now we are turning, you know, we went from what? Minus, 2,380 to plus 11, right? Okay, in a month of time. That is extraordinary, right? So we'll keep an eye on this new high, new low in the coming week. If the market do decide to come down and take out this low or retest this low, we want to see with the new high, new low come down at least to this level and retest this 2,380 level, or would it just barely come dip below the negative area? So again, that sort of reinforced that a lot of stock is already sold off and made it slow or put in the bottom for this particular cycle. Okay, so it's become a what we call a stock picking market, right? So, you know, not all stock is going to be dumped like when we in a massive sell-off like we saw in the February, March timeframe. So those are the some of the way to look at the new high, new low. You know, basically, the way that I use it is, you know, look at the extreme along with the divergence, right? So if the index is moving to new low, I would also expect that the new high, new low get weaker. In other words, get more negative. Okay, but if it doesn't, then that kind of tell me that, hey, internally the market is not as weak as the index is indicating, and vice versa, all right? So now that this is the up-down volume that I added, from previous video, I did not have the up-down volume ratio on it to talk about, but right now I added to this chart. The up-down volume ratio is basically is the daily up volume divided by the down volume from New York Stock Exchange if the up volume is greater than the down volume, right? So to get a positive ratio. But if the down volume is higher than the up volume, then we take the down volume divided by the up volume to get that ratio, and we will mark that as a negative value. So when you see a negative value, that means there are more down volume than up volume for that particular trading session. And if it's positive, then that means there's more up volume than down volume for that trading session. So why is it significant? Well, the thing is that once again, we want to see the strength, the internal strength of the market. If the index is being pushed up, we want to see more up volume pushing it up rather than more down volume. See, so that would, if we get more down volume, then that would be disguising the fake move of the index, right? So again, you basically look at a little bit of a divergence, and also the extreme, right? The extreme, see, if you look at this day here on 3-9, March 9, you see the S&P 500 close up here at 27.46.56, and you see the up-down volume ratio is minus 40, right? So there are a lot of down volume, a lot of selling pressure here, right? Okay, so then you go to the next level here, you know, at this stage here, it actually make a lower low, okay, on the S&P, but you look at the up-down volume ratio is only minus 22, so that's an improvement, right? Then you come down here to March 23rd, right, where S&P put in a new low here, right? And look at the up-down volume, right? It's only minus 2.67. Comparing to this day here, it's minus 40. And where was it at minus 40? It was up here, and now it's down here. So again, it kind of gives you some idea, some perspective that, you know, this is the last holdout capitulation, right? Okay, because what a lot of people that need to sell or want to sell at all costs, at any price, they basically sold right in this area, okay? All right, so now we see that on Friday, the up-down volume ratio is actually positive 3.7. So, you know, it's an improvement, right? It's an improvement. It does support the move up, although there was some fading going on doing, because it's option expiration on Thursday also, right? So we expect some trickery thing that they're going to play in the last hour, or last half an hour stuff. Okay, because at one time, I think I noticed that the up-down volume ratio in today basis, it was up at plus 30 at one point. So certainly when you look at that, and then when it closed at 3.7, it seemed like, oh, you know, there seems to be some selling toward the close. And that could be it, right? So we'll see, but at least, you know, that's how I use these, you know, market internal and the sentiment indicator to get a bigger picture of what the market is actually doing underneath the index. You know, is it the underlying market is gathering strength or, you know, getting weaker, right? So right now the market is telling me that, hey, you know, it is trying to rebuild. It is trying to rebuild, okay? Everything is moving accordingly, so no divergence, but that doesn't mean that these divergence could not pop up. I mean, that's basically what I'm monitored for, is these divergence to kind of give me a clue of which side or which direction to be prepared for, you know. So with that said, let's go and analyze the price action and see where are some of the resistance and support level that we might keep an eye on for the coming day. But definitely right now with the internal, okay, it appeared that the March 23rd low signified there is an internal low. Now, the index could come down and test that level, but here's the key. We need to monitor the stock market internal to see are those internal making a new low or turning worse, you know, to agreement with the move of the index. If they do, then that means we could see the next leg down. But if they do not, then there could be another buying opportunity there. Okay, now, is it justifiable for the market doing what it's doing based on the, you know, the corona crisis, the economy shutting down, the unemployment, you know, disruption of the economy and that kind of stuff? Hey, I'm not here trying to justify the market's movement. I'm just here to analyze what the market is trying to do and see how I would be able to make money off of it, right? You're not playing the market just so you could say, oh, I'm right, I'm wrong. Hey, that's not my objective. My objective with playing the market is to make money. That's my only objective, right? Now, you might say that, oh, that's kind of naive or self, you know, narrow-minded. Hey, but that's the truth, right? That is the truth. I'm not going to lie to you. But you could lie to yourself if you want, but I am not going to lie to you, right? I'm here to play this game to make money. All right, so with that said, let's go and take a look at the price action. And by the way, if you find these information, you know, to be useful and informative, give it a thumbs up. That will help me a lot. So let's go and take a look at the price action. Okay, here I got a couple of these Fibonacci retracement. Let me take this out first and put that back in later on. Last week, I was talking about this retracement here, right? You know, this swing up and pull back to this 618, somewhere around 2,466 or 2,467, right? This area here, Right. And we're basically looking for this to bounce off the 618 and come up to this zone here between the 2711 and 2641 range here, you know, to come up to this zone and see would it be able to get to that zone. And you can see right now, you know, as of Friday, actually got up to this 141, but prior to Friday, it was actually bumping against this 127 level here at 2758. Right. Then on Friday, I just move up and attack the 141. So right now, what I see is I have a couple of these potential, right? Potential resistance is up here at this 161 near 2912 level, you know, 2912. So the possibility is for this thing to come up and hit this 161 to see what it get resistant and push it back to down to this 100% here, this 2637 level. All right, so basically you're looking at this 161, the 2912 area as one potential resistant. Okay, and if it could get to this 2912, then I'd be looking at this this level up here somewhere around 3136, this area, and essentially above this 200% extension on this retracement. Okay, so that's a couple possibility on the upside, right? Then on the downside, because you're looking at this, it's basically a spinning top candle here on Friday, and if we do get a negative day on Monday, then this could set up a little bit of a evening star type of a candle stick pattern. Then I expect it to maybe come down to this trend line, essentially come down and check this 100% the 2037 level for potential support and see would it get some support and bounces it back up toward the 161. Right, but if it could not hold the support, then I expect it to see what it come down and find support here at the 618 around 2467. So that also fill this gap down here. And then depending how it's gonna do when it get down to the 61, I mean when it get down to this 61.8 at 2467, would it be able to get a bounce back up or will break that support? Then we're basically looking at 2300 down here, and that will essentially come down and fill this gap here. So that is basically the price action that I will be watching for. And there are, you know, another way to look at the Fibonacci retracement. People are looking at this, and we're basically looking for confluence. So you can see that there is a 50% retracement, and the Friday actually closed near that 50%. And also this 50% is in confluence with this 141 and 127. So this could be a little bit of a chopping zone and see would it be able to chop around and then push up. And this 1618 is also in confluence with this 282 near the 2934. So that could be a you know, another confluence for this potential resistance zone up here at this 2912. All right, so those are some of the confluence that I'm looking at. And also again, at this 100%, right, it's also in confluence with this 618. And this support area could have a little bit of a confluence for this thing to hold this back up. All right, so that is essentially my take on the S&P 500 for the coming week. So let's go and take a look at the gold market and then the oil and the U.S. dollar. Okay, looking at the gold, you see last week we were essentially looking at this retracement zone. And we're saying that we were looking for the gold to see would it be able to get back above this 1704. If it could get back above this 1704, then we're essentially looking for this 127 extension somewhere around 1850. Right? So we're essentially monitoring gold to see would it be able to move itself up toward the 1850 level. And you know, so we got this little trend line here. And essentially inside of this retracement zone, you see that got a nice bounce off the retracement zone and work itself back up toward this 100% at 1704 and book it. And right now it's making its way, trying to get up to this 1850. And if we take a look at on the daily chart here, So here, looking at the daily chart, you can see gold, came up, kind of got rejected a little bit on the 1704.30, and then got an NR7. NR7, and then we got this big push on Thursday, and talk about that. So essentially, if you look at this here also, it looked like a inverted head and shoulder pattern, right? So you could also have that sort of trace that up. And if we put a, do a little bit of a major move, and let me see here. So a major move on 100%, that would put it at 1926, and that would be somewhere around this 141 extension. And at 80%, close to 1880 area here, right? So that's a possibility. Right now, we're basically looking at this 127 extension at 1850. Okay, looking at crude oil, we see that the crude oil is kind of got a little bit of a bounce. Remember, we saw this low here in 1927 and came back up. We're essentially monitoring this 161 at somewhere around this $21 level. And you see it kind of snap back, and last week it got a inside week here and the OPEC meeting. And right now with the newswire saying that the OPEC had agreed to do a production cut, I believe 9.7 million barrel a day. They were initially talking about 10. So we'll see how the price will react when the market open for trading. But right now it seems like it might want to come back up here. And essentially, I was looking at this this zone here. Remember, basically near the 20 area to the low mid 30, right? Okay, so if we go and take a look at the daily price chart. So here on the daily price chart here, you see that it could be forming a little bit of a bull flag, right? So if we do a little bit of a major move, and essentially that would put this thing up to somewhere around the 32 area, right? So kind of keep an eye on that to see would this thing react positively to the new agreement and push this up to this 32 area, or would it be basically just kind of, get basically sell the news, buy the rumor, sell the news thing, and might come down and chop around and retest this 1927 area. So, but bear in mind, I still be watching for this area to see would it be able to chop around in this zone. Unless it breaks below this 1927, then we're probably looking at a new round of downward prices. But for now, basically looking to see what it get a positive reaction and at least come up to this 30 area and maybe stabilize there and chop around and work toward this upper zone here, somewhere around this 35, right? And get that resistance and push it back up. So kind of, form a little bit of a base here for the next move. And here looking at the US dollar, this is a weekly chart here. You see this channel, it came back up to this channel the prior week and then was basically looking for a pullback because with a strong dollar, it's not good, right? Because so we're basically looking, still monitoring for a pullback down to this trend line here in this channel here. And ultimately, I'm looking forward to come back down to this level near the 95. So right now, basically looking at the 97.5 area. And here looking at the daily price, you can see that it came up, found resistance at this upper channel, and now it's pulling back. So we're gonna see, would it be able to pull back down at least to the lower channel here near the 97.5, right? So there you have it, my analysis of the S&P 500 and also the gold, oil, and the US dollar for this week. As you can see that there is still a lot of uncertainty in the market, but the market seems to be showing a little bit of life on the upside. So we have to still remain to be a little bit cautionary because all codes are not clear, although we are seeing a little bit of a positive sign on some of the internal. But there are still a lot of uncertainty, and anything could change, this market and reverse it at a moment, right? Because there are still a lot of fear in the market, and we basically just have to be careful, but don't get hysterical or panicky. because we have to act rational to win this game, right? So, and also be sure to maintain your good health, you know, adhere to the guideline, keep that social distancing, so keep yourself safe and also other people safe. So thank you for watching, and be sure to give it a like if you find the content in this video to be informative and useful to you, and also subscribe if you're not a subscriber to this channel. Thank you very much, and good luck, and stay safe.